So in this lecture, we will be dealing with the process of thrombus formation known as thrombosis. So normal hemostasis is responsible for maintaining blood in fluid state and to stop bleeding when there is injury by hemostatic plug formation. The general sequence of events in hemostasis or vasoconstriction: primary hemostasis, secondary hemostasis, and finally the containment of clot progression through activation of fibrinolysis. Vasoconstriction is mediated by reflex neurogenic mechanism and endothelin released by injured endothelium. So primary hemostasis is achieved by plated plug formation and it is a weak seal at the site of injury. Secondary hemostasis is facilitated through activation of coagulation system and fibrin clot formation, and this clot is a strong seal to the injured area. Once the purpose is achieved, that is stoppage of bleeding, further progression of clotting process should be stopped. This is done by activation of fibrinolytic system through tissue plasminogen activator. So this is the diagrammatic representation. You can see that injured area associated with narrowing of lumen due to reflex vasoconstriction, and endothelial discontinuity exposes the subendothelial collagen, and wherein you will see von Willebrand's factor gluing the platelets to the exposed collagen. So this is adhesion, and later there will be aggregation of platelets and release of platelet content, ultimately forming a platelet plug which is weaker in containing the bleeding. But in the course of time, there will be activation of coagulation factors and which entrap the cellular elements of the blood and fibrin meshwork formation, which is a stronger clot to prevent bleeding. This is a diagrammatic representation of platelet adhesion and aggregation. You can see that exposed collagen, and the platelets are adhered to that exposed collagen through von Willebrand's factor. And von Willebrand's factor binds with the platelets through glycoprotein 1b. Aggregation takes place with binding of glycoprotein 2b, 3a molecule through the fibrinogen. Later, there will be release reaction which is responsible for platelet plug formation. So, coagulation cascade is classically divided into extrinsic, intrinsic, and common pathways, with factor 12, 11, 9 and 8 forming the intrinsic limb, and tissue factor 7 forming the extrinsic pathway. Both converge on factor 10 with the formation of thrombin and fibrin clot, which is the representative of common pathway. So this will help us to understand the cascade, interpret lab coagulation tests, and also treat the patient. But in vivo, tissue factor 7, factor 9 are important, and the pathways are interlinked. The practical aspect of this slide is to show you that activation of factor 9 can be done by activated factor 7. This is 10 times more potent than intrinsic limb as such. So importance of this knowledge is that when hemophilia A patient develops antibodies to exogenous factor 8 concentrate, bleeding in these patients can be stopped by giving excessive factor 7, which bypasses factor 8 by activating directly factor 9. Once the secondary hemostatic plug is formed, further progression of clot will be stopped by activation of fibrinolytic system through tissue plasminogen activator and also urokinase. This diagram represents some of the properties of endothelium that favor and also inhibit thrombosis. Those favor thrombosis include tissue factor released from endothelium and subendothelial collagen, which binds with von Willebrand's factor, thereby inviting binding with platelets. So endothelial derivatives that inhibit thrombosis include thrombomodulin, heparin-like molecule, tissue factor pathway inhibitor, and tissue plasminogen activator. Thrombomodulin binds with thrombin. This activates protein C. Activated protein C cleaves activated factor 5 and factor 8. Heparin-like molecule binds antithrombin 3, which in turn cleaves activated factors 9 and 10. Tissue factor pathway inhibitor inactivates activated factor 7 and 10. So tissue plasminogen activator activates fibrinolytics, altogether inhibits thrombosis. One more point to be noted is endothelium also produces prostaglandin I2 and nitric oxide. Prostaglandin I2 is a platelet inhibitor and nitric oxide is a vasodilator. So all these things will prevent the thrombogenesis. Coming to the thrombosis proper. So as you know, blood contains plasma and cells. Cellular components include WBC to RBC and platelets. Plasma components include protein, electrolytes and water. Coagulation factors are included in this protein. So by definition, thrombus is a blood clot, and thrombosis is a process which is pathological and whereby there is formation of blood clots within the vascular compartment. And it may be associated or may not be associated with endothelial injury. So hemostatic balance is between procoagulant factors and anticoagulant factors, which we have seen earlier. And now in thrombosis, this tips towards procoagulant factors. So before going to the thrombus proper, let us review what is an embolus. Embolus is a detached intravascular solid, liquid or gaseous mass that is carried by the blood to a site distant from the point of origin. Virchow enumerated three components which when altered may result in thrombus formation. These three components are known as Virchow triad, and which include the endothelial injury, abnormal blood flow and hypercoagulable state. So examples for this endothelial injury is hypercholesterolemia and inflammation. Abnormal blood flow may be seen in the form of stasis, or it may be associated with turbulence. So examples for stasis is the bedridden patient or varicosities or this atrial fibrillation, which is inefficient in pumping the blood into the ventricle. For turbulence, atherosclerotic vessel which is narrowed, or coarctation of aorta, or septal defects, atrial, interventricular septal defects, which may result in turbulence. Examples for hypercoagulability is inherited genetic abnormalities like factor 5 Leiden, or disseminated cancers which are acquired type of thrombotic tendencies. Even though we enumerated individually these three components, these three components are also interrelated. For example, abnormal blood flow by itself can cause thrombosis, or it may precipitate thrombus formation by causing endothelial injury. Another example is endothelial injury can cause hypercoagulable state due to decreased synthesis of anticoagulants. Coming to the first component of the triad, that is endothelial injury. Whenever there is endothelial injury, there is exposure of subendothelial collagen, which invites binding with von Willebrand's factor and platelets, forming a plug, which we'll call this thrombus. And whenever there is endothelial injury, endothelium enters into a state of endothelial activation, wherein you'll see genetic expression shifting towards prothrombotic protein synthesis. So this may be due to the procoagulant changes like downregulation of thrombomodulin, protein C and tissue factor protein inhibitor, or may be due to anti-fibrinolytic effects, wherein you'll see secretion of plasminogen activator inhibitors, and also by down-regulating the expression of tissue plasminogen activators. And endothelial injury can be precipitated by physical injury, infectious agents, abnormal blood flow, inflammatory mediators, or metabolic abnormalities like hypercholesterolemia, hyperhomocysteinemia, and also toxins liberated or derived from cigarette smoke. This image shows the normal aorta. Appreciate the luminal surface or the endothelial surface of the aorta, which is smooth and glistening, and compare the surface of the aorta, which is involved in atherosclerotic process of varying degrees. So there is roughening and shaggy appearance of the luminal surface, which invite thrombus formation due to either by stimulating turbulence, or it may be due to exposure of subendothelial collagen. So this is the transverse section of an artery wherein the lumen shows the blood clots, which we'll call as thrombus. And important histological finding of a thrombus is its attachment to the injured area. And again, one more artery showing extensive atherosclerosis with the thrombus formation. So coming to the second component of varicose striatum, that is abnormal blood flow. And abnormal blood flow can be due to stasis, or it may be due to turbulence. So turbulence promotes endothelial activation, enhancing procoagulant activity and leukocyte adhesion, or it may bring platelets in contact with the endothelium, or it may prevent dilution of the activated clotting factors, and it may also retard inflow of clotting factor inhibitors, so thereby causing prothrombotic tendencies in areas of turbulence. So the clinical examples for abnormal blood flow is aneurysms and enlarged left atrium in mitral stenosis, and also sickle cell anemia, polycythemia vera. In aneurysms, there is stasis and also turbulence. In enlarged left atrium, there is stasis mainly. And in the case of sickle cell anemia, sluggish circulation, clogging of vascular tree promotes thrombogenesis. In the case of polycythemia vera, because of excessive cellular component, there is sluggish circulation and increased viscosity, which favors thrombogenesis. And this image shows the aorta, abdominal aorta with the kidneys, and notice the infrarenal portion of the abdominal aorta is dilated. It is due to aneurysm, and such aneurysm is a seat for turbulence and activation of coagulation system. And in this specimen shows the opened up left atrium, left ventricle, and left atrium shows a mass attached to the inner surface, and this is the secondary to stasis and blood clot formation in the left atrium. Coming to the third component of varicose striatum, that is hypercoagulability. And this hypercoagulable state may predispose to thrombus formation by altering the coagulation pathway, or it may be due to increased viscosity of blood, which changes the flow dynamics. So this table shows the causes for hypercoagulable states, primary and secondary. And primary, you should know, are associated with some genetic abnormalities. They are known as factor 5 mutation and prothrombin mutation, and increased levels of factor 8, 9 and 11 and fibrinogen. And rare causes for hypercoagulable states, which are genetic in origin, or antithrombin 3 deficiency, protein C and protein S deficiency. There are many secondary causes for hypercoagulable state, and most commonly you will come across the rest or immobilized patients, and myocardial infarction, atrial fibrillation, tissue injury due to surgery or fracture or burns, or the patients suffering from cancers, especially adenocarcinomas, and prosthetic cardiac valves, disseminated intravascular coagulation, heparin induced thrombocytopenia, and antiphospholipid syndrome. So lower risk of thrombosis may be encountered in patients with nephrotic syndrome, cardiomyopathy, and those who are using oral contraceptives, or the hyperestenic states like pregnancy and postpartum. So hypercoagulable state are particularly associated with venous thrombus formation. This slide shows some of the examples for primary hypercoagulable states. And factor 5 mutation, otherwise known as factor 5 Leiden, is associated with recurrent deep vein thrombosis. Heterozygotes for this mutation exhibit 5 times increased risk for thrombosis, whereas homozygotes have 50 times increased risk for venous thrombosis. And prothrombin mutation is due to single nucleotide change, and it leads to elevated prothrombin levels and makes the person susceptible for venous thrombosis by 3 times. Antithrombin 3, protein C, protein S deficiencies are associated again with venous thrombosis, and recurrent thromboembolism may begin in the adolescence and early adulthood. Elevated homocysteine levels may show both arterial and venous thrombosis. So mainly, arterial thrombus is due to endothelial injury, whereas venous thrombus formation is due to stasis. Primary hypercoagulable state should be suspected in any patient who is less than 50 years of age presenting with thrombus, even when there is some acquired noticeable risk factors in such patients. Coming to secondary hypercoagulable states, among them two important things. One is heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, HIT syndrome, and other one is antiphospholipid syndrome. So heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, it is an autoimmune condition wherein there will be autoantibody production against the platelet factors. So this is most commonly seen in the use of unfractionated heparin, and these antibodies are formed against the complex of heparin with platelet factor 4 or something like heparin-like molecules and platelet factor-like proteins that are present in the endothelium. Once these antibodies are formed, they react with platelets and they activate the platelets, thereby increasing the tendency for thrombosis. And due to this activation, there is consumption of platelet and the patient lands in thrombocytopenia. So heparin-induced thrombocytopenia is a hypercoagulable state even though there is thrombocytopenia. Antiphospholipid syndrome should be suspected in any patient who is presenting with recurrent thrombosis, repeated miscarriages or cardiac vegetations and thrombocytopenia. And the antibodies are produced against beta 2 glycoprotein 1, which is present on the endothelial cells and also trophoblastic elements, and some of the antibodies are produced against thrombin. So coming to the morphology of thrombus, thrombi may develop anywhere in the cardiovascular system, and they are of variable sizes and shapes, and arterial or cardiac thrombi usually begin at the site of endothelial injury, and venous thrombi characteristically occur at the site of stasis. The characteristic feature of thrombus is the firm attachment to the point of origin. So thrombus can grow. If it is arterial thrombus, it grows in a retrograde direction, where if it is venous thrombi, it grows in the direction of blood flow. So complication of thrombus is embolism. So coming to morphology of thrombus, there are certain factors which you should consider, that is lines of John, mural thrombi, arterial thrombi, venous thrombosis and phlebothrombosis and vegetations. So this is an aortic aneurysm showing abnormally dilated abdominal aorta, and thinned out wall can be noticed. Within the lumen, there is some clot which is showing alternating layers of pale and red areas. They are known as lines of John, and these lines of John, when you examine under microscope, are composed of the RBC, which represents red areas grossly, and pale areas are represented by platelets and fibrin. So this is infective endocarditis, wherein you can see aortic wall showing large vegetations. This is also one of the examples of our thrombus formation. So this is the Lippmann Sachs endocarditis. You can see that small vegetations along the lines of closure. And this is also one of the examples for thrombus formation. So this is cut surface of the ventricles showing mural thrombi within the lumen. And notice the whitish fibrous scar underneath this mural thrombi. This table enumerates the differences between arterial and venous thrombi. What is important is the appearance of arterial and venous thrombi. The color of arterial thrombi is gray-white, whereas venous thrombi are usually red. Consistency, arterial thrombi are friable, venous thrombi are firm in consistency, and arterial thrombi usually occlusive, but venous thrombi always they occlude the vessel completely. So endothelial injury is a prerequisite for arterial thrombus formation, whereas it may not be present in venous thrombus formation. The site usually coronary, cerebral and femoral vessels in the case of arterial thrombi. Venous thrombi, lower limbs are the most common. Lower limbs are the most common sites, and dural sinuses, portal vein are the second in line. This slide enumerates the difference between venous thrombi and postmortem clot. Postmortem clots are gelatinous, they have two portions. One is the dependent portion will be dark red and superficial portion will be yellow. And that is the reason why it is described as chicken fat appearance. And this dark red dependent portion is composed of RBCs. Yellow portion is nothing but coagulated plasma. These postmortem clots are not usually attached to the underlying vessel wall. In contrast, red thrombi are firmer, almost always have a point of attachment, and on transection reveal vague strands of pale gray fibrin. This table enumerates the differences between venous thrombi and postmortem clots, and venous thrombi are always adherent at one point, whereas postmortem clots are not adherent, and the color of venous thrombi are red, whereas postmortem clot clearly shows two layers. One is red and yellow layer. And consistency firm in the case of venous thrombus or postmortem clot or gelatinous. Site mainly in venous thrombi is seen in the lower limbs, dural sinuses and portal vein, whereas postmortem clot can be seen anywhere in the body. Coming to the fate of thrombus, four events in the ensuing days to weeks can be appreciated, and thrombus may propagate from the site of origin. It can go involve distant sites, and the thrombus may become organized, recanalized. So inflammation can come in, and with the new vascularization, probably there is recanalization and establishment of recirculation. The thrombus may become organized and incorporated into the vessel wall, or thrombus may dissolve completely and disappear, leaving the lumen intact. So this is an example for resolution. And the thrombus may dislodge and become an embolus. So this diagram represents the arterial lumen blocked by a blood clot. We'll call it as thrombus. And sometimes this completely dissolve and leaving no traces. We'll call this as resolution. And they may dislodge and travel to a distant site. We'll call this as embolization. They may get incorporated within the vessel wall, and you'll call this organization. And organization can also occur secondary to inflammation with recanalization and re-establishment of circulation in the thrombosed area. So classification of thrombi depends upon the anatomical site where thrombus has occurred, or morphological appearances of thrombi. Depending upon the anatomical site, the thrombus can be cardiac thrombus or arterial, venous or capillary thrombi. Whereas in the case of morphological appearances, the thrombus can be red or pale or mixed. So a mixed thrombus, you can see pale and red areas. And venous thrombosis, two distinct types of thrombosis associated with veins or phlebothrombosis and thrombophlebitis. Phlebothrombosis is associated with thromboembolism to the lungs, whereas thrombophlebitis, initial event is inflammation which causes injury to the endothelium, causing thrombus formation. They are attached very firmly, so thromboembolism is a rare event with thrombophlebitis. And one more important thing you should remember regarding this thrombophlebitis is migratory thrombophlebitis, otherwise known as Trousseau's syndrome. So which is commonly seen in the case of persons suffering from adenocarcinomas, especially pancreatic variety of adenocarcinomas. So these patients exhibit migratory variety of thrombophlebitis involving one limb on one day, the other limb after a few days. So this is important sign of internal malignancy, especially the carcinoma of pancreas. So effects of thrombi depends upon the location and degree of vascular occlusion, and also availability of collateral blood supply in the affected tissue and susceptibility of the tissue to the hypoxia. Thank you.
The references for most of the pathology lectures are pathology textbooks, mainly including Robbins and Cottrell, Pathologic Basis of Disease, and images from online sources.
Thanks for watching. Click subscribe and click like if you like the video.